A very good morning to all. I think, you see, biometry, as they say, is the cornerstone. And biometry is the cornerstone, as I said, and I think my previous speaker did some part of the job for me. My previous speaker did part of my job, so I'll be skipping some slides. But let me tell you one thing. First of all, I have no commercial interest in all the stuff for the machine names or the procedures I'll be naming. What does the patient doesn't know? The patient doesn't know one thing, that how difficult it is to operate in 2 to 3, 4 millimeters of an eye space. The patient doesn't know what it means to cut the capsule to a perfect round circle. The patient doesn't know what efforts the surgeon goes through to keep the cornea clean. What the patient knows is, post-surgery, he can't see clearly, whatever may be the reason. So how a patient sees directly translates to what the patient perceives the surgeon to be. You could be the swankiest cat's whiskers surgeon in town. If the patient doesn't have the vision he was expecting, you're a bad surgeon. So biometry, if it's off the mark, if the patient has an off-mark biometry, the patient actually thinks the surgery has gone wrong. Now, when a patient comes to for a cataract surgery to us, how many of you agree that he comes for a cataract surgery? Only one. He actually comes for a clear vision. He doesn't come for a cataract surgery. This is where the disconnect between the doctor and the patient. Patient is coming for a clear vision. He doesn't care. You could have taken out a white cataract, but if the biometry is off, he's unhappy. He feels surgery has not gone well. So a bad or a bad vision post-op is equal to a bad surgeon. So let's be a little wise here. You can't please them all, which I'm sure Dr. Pooja is going to be talking about few outcomes where everything is happy, surgeon is happy, but the patient is happy. So don't feel bad. Try your best. Always make sure that the patient's expectations are realistic. Avoid using the word that I guarantee this. Never say give the credit to the machine or the IOL, because guess what happens? When you give the credit to a very expensive machine or the IOL, when things go well, the patient doesn't give you the credit. He feels because he paid for that expensive IOL, he got that result. But what if something goes wrong? Who gets the abuses? You, not the machine. So always take the credit if something goes right. And if something goes wrong, then you're there, of course. There's no running away from that. So accurate biometry is happy patients will lead to a growth in practice. Now always communicate realistic situations, otherwise you'll be looking for a place to hide yourself. Patients looking for you in the clinic because you said something and you couldn't fulfill that. So the idea is to be committed to have the patient happy towards having lowest possible refractive error, but do not let the patient get attached to it. Let your team work for it, but the patient should be detached from that. That takes a little bit of art to make the patients come to that. Now, what are the issues which you will actually experience when you're targeting emmetropia? Post-refractive cases, which were well covered by the previous speaker, silicone oil, pediatric cases, corneal scars, dry eye diseases. Now, this is a huge thing which is now we're seeing in our practices now. Surface disorders. Now, most of us are ignoring surface disorders. Any patient with surface disorder will give you a bad keratometry. And a bad keratometry will add up to a bad refractive outcome. So let's see. I would say a perfect target emmetropia, it's a journey. It's not a destination. Every day you need to work towards it. You need to, your team needs to work to it. You need, as the previous speaker said, you need to use different machines, different equipment, collaborate, take an average. Now, what are the reasons for hurry? What happens when things go wrong? Everything is perfect. Staff is in hurry, you're in a hurry. Data entry is wrong. Axis is marked wrongly. I've had cases where the axis has gone 90 degrees off just because my data entry person is doing something wrong in the system, he's talking to his girlfriend on the phone, he punches in the wrong data, and the IOL goes wrong. So people in hurry, wrong A constants, the patient has changed the lens at the last moment, but somebody's just not updated the IOL power, it's gone straight at the original power. wrong keratometry reading, compression of the cornea in case of applanation, reversed optic of the IOL, capsular fibrosis, wrong formula used. Maybe a wrong formula was used. So basic rules are, the smaller the eye, even a little amount of error will cause more error for the patient. Larger the eye, myopic eyes are more forgiving for a commonsensical reason. Now these are kind of red flags which are available in my all clinics, available, they're printed, these are big posters lying next to the optometrist. There is a protocol, induction protocol, all optometrists need to go through it, they need to memorize it. Then there's a written exam. So if an optometrist, there are some protocols for using an OCT, there are protocols, he sits, he has to go through them, memorize them and write them down and then come for an exam for a senior optometrist. So these things are lying, and don't miss those signs there, the danger signs, which means if he's not followed them, the boss is going to get angry. There are some points it says, kindly discuss with Dr. Kamal. So these points should be there within visible range, because you could have optometrists which are on rotation. They could be changing positions and pose. So the first one could be very diligent and very efficient, the second one could not. So how do you make system and process take over human beings and people? This is what you do. Changing from one biometry to another biometry, changing from an applanation to immersion, immersion to this thing. One thing I would say, the bottom line is calibration of your equipment and calibration and service. Very often you will see your autorefractometer is giving wrong readings because somebody, some child has just come and touched the lens. There's a mark on the lens. Your Cirrus mapper or your Pentacam lens will have a mark on it. Somebody's touched it. Your machine, biometry machine, there is some problem. The wrong formula has been entered or wrong A constant has been entered and printouts are going on that. So when you want to change from applanation to immersion, it's a good idea to add a 0.3 A constant into it, because there is a compression of approximately 150 to 180 microns. I'm giving you very, very broad outlines because emetropia target is a huge, huge ocean. I was just talking to Dr. Pooja that this is a long topic, I'm trying to compress it. In case you're shifting from immersion to the optical, in my system, we add 0.38 or 0.04 A constant into the lens. Or what you could do is you could go to the ULIP site, and for there are most of the lenses we use, even the Indian lenses are listed there. You can use them, you can add those things there in the system. Optical biometry, but of course, is very, very useful, especially in cases which are unique, they're corneal scars, and with the newer optical biometers like IOLMaster 700, Tommy, these machines are able to penetrate even bad cataracts where the earlier IOLMaster 500 or the other previous machines were not able to do that. Now, these are the formulas you would like to change if you're changing from immersion to an optical system. So in case you're using an SRKT, where I said just add 0.4, but in case you're using these formulas, these are the buffer factors you add in as you move on. So these things are printed in the optical room and they're in the software. Average formulas, average eyes, most often we use SRKT, less than 20 millimeters. There are different people have different favorites. I have some doctors in my organization who prefer a Hofer Q over Haggis. Some people prefer Haggis. But yes, the borderline is I would prefer a Hofer Q between 20 to 22. Another thing is, as the previous speaker said, the keratometric constants are very, very important. What machine are you using? Keratometric constants are those things which are used to convert the millimeter radius to a diopter. These are the division factors. Now, if your machine is calibrated at a different keratometric constant, it will induce approximately 0.8 to 1 diopter of error. So make sure that the manufacturer who supplied this stuff to you, he's calibrated the constant to the ones which you're using in your formula. Now, post-RK, I'll just go very fast. Very, very important to take history. There are a lot of times lady patients in our country will hide the fact that they've got an PRK done in front of their mother-in-law. So a lot of times my optometrist, he's alert, he's sharp, he comes to me and says, sir, the keratometry is 37, and the lady says she's not been operated. So I make an excuse for the mother-in-law to leave the room, and then I say, then she says, Dr. Kapoor, please don't tell my mother-in-law that I got operated for PRK. So history taking, careful examination, slit lamp examination will also add to your achievement of PRK. If you just operate this patient normally, you're in for a bad surprise. These patients who got previous surgery done, they'll be really pushing you because they were the ones who were not happy wearing glasses. So now they'll push you to assure that yes, even cataract surgery, after cataract surgery, you will not require glasses. Now that's wrong. These patients are very pushy. Do not succumb to the pressure. Push them back. These patients will actually be very unhappy. I think I'll need to go fast. I'll just go to very, very salient points. There are a few things, these things. Diurnal variation in RK has been noticed. Dr. Holliday has said that these patients who come early in the morning, they will be hyperopic. So patients who've got more than 14 cuts and above, if you do their keratometry in the morning and their refraction in the morning is different than the afternoon. So there is a hypothesis for that. One more thing is these RK patients will have a decay over time. They'll have a hyperopic shift. So plan that, tell the patient. Next thing you need to tell these patients of post-RK is that your refraction will change after 2 to 3 months. So make sure the glasses you make, the real glasses will probably settle in after 2 to 3 months. Post-LASIK, again, I think formulas. Thank you, I got to skip. Thank you.
Thanks.